All right, let's begin. We'll pray. Father, we thank you for this day, a day of light and beauty and opportunity. We thank you for the privilege we have of gathering here to study your word. And at the end of a long day, we ask that you will alert our minds and open our hearts, that we may grasp your truth. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. So this is now lesson number 5 in Paul's letter to the church at Rome. We're in the first chapter. We're going to finish the first chapter tonight. And consequently, find out getting a base for this book. Without this first chapter and some things that appear in chapter 2 and 3, the rest of the book does not make sense. Now, if we're just studying an ancient letter and picking up a piece of history, this time we spend has no value. You have to be asking, what does this have to do with me? And what does this have to do with the world in which we find ourselves at the present time? I have the local Tribune dated March 26 through April 1st, which happens to be today. And the heading across the page is, Woman Gets 8 Years for Fire District Theft Scheme. Well, this lady filched $352,000 between 2009 and 2012. It's Michelle Sopko, 46 years old, lives in Oak Forest, and was employed by the Palos Park, or the Palos Heights Fire Protection District. She had created 2 phantom employees to whom she wrote checks, salary checks that were diverted to her own account. And this went on for several years until, of course, be sure your sin will find you out. So she's going to get free board and room for 8 years now. And what I want is your take, your reaction on her comment for stealing $352,000 from the citizens, really, the Palos Heights Fire Protection District. She said Monday, a week ago this Monday, that she made, quote, a terrible mistake. What is your reaction to that? What?
Her mistake was she got caught.
What's your reaction to her assessment, Jeanette?
She's minimizing the situation by saying that.
Minimizing. A mistake is something you might make on your computer and delete and back up, you know. What's she reluctant to do?
She's reluctant to admit that she's not a good person. She
admitted she was guilty, by the way. Yes.
She doesn't want to admit that she's a sinner.
She does not want to come clean that this is a sin. The word sin has gone out of style, and nobody sins anymore. Haven't you noticed? There are failures, mess-ups, boo-boos, it's not so bad, but maybe I should have done it another way. All kinds of euphemisms. As you said, to minimize what?
Lifestyle choices.
I made a wrong lifestyle choice. Isn't that a good cover for a mess to put on it? Huh? I made a bad lifestyle choice. Well, with all of that, we have to go to Romans 1:18, which heads this section that we're in presently. For the wrath of God is revealed against. So something is serious enough, something is deviant enough, something is out of whack enough for God to get angry with it. And consequently, these are serious matters. They're not just slip-ups, you know, or I kind of missed it. No, they're serious. There, we're at verse 24, therefore, and the passage turns on the therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies. So, why is a body honorable if it can be dishonored? Then it has to be honorable. Why is a body, a human body, honorable? Dead silence. What?
We were made in the image of God.
All right, we're created by God. So this, our bodies are His handiwork, much marred, abused by the fall and everything that has come since Adam and Eve. You've never seen a perfect person walking around, and everyone in this room, of course, there is something wrong with you physically. This is true of every human being. You've never been to the dentist, you got glasses on, you know. It would be amazing. There's something wrong. So, but our bodies are honorable because they've been made, created by God. And so they dishonor their bodies among themselves because they exchange the truth of God for a lie. Worship, serve the creature more than the creator. 26, for this reason God gave them up. And in other words, God is saying, if this is the way you want to think, if this is the way you want to live, if this is what you have your heart set on, you have free will, I'm turning you loose, go for it. Do what you want. Do what you want. Which is a terrible kind of thing. In other words, God just let them loose. I'll never forget, I was a preteen at the time. I don't know exactly what age. But my father took my raising somewhat seriously. We had a basement in our house. We had a coal-burning furnace in the spring and the fall. We burned trash in it and wood and so on. And we had a large box down there with a lid on it. It was table high. And to went trash went, we'd use it for starting fires in the furnace fall and spring. And that's where my dad took me to settle accounts with me. I was to lie across this box. He removed his belt, and you can turn your imagination loose on what followed this. And I'll never forget the time I'm on the box, his belt is out, but he's saying, this is the last time I'm going to whip you. Scared the life out of me. In other words, I had been so mischievous and so out of pattern that I thought, hey, is my dad giving up on me? That shook me more than the belt that night. So God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, and it says to dishonor their bodies among themselves. Verse 26, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for the women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. God made the woman and designed her naturally for relations in marriage. And the men, the women, verse 26, the men, verse 27, the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men, receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. This is one of the several passages in Scripture on deviant, perverted, unnatural sexual relationships. This is not sprung in the New Testament. Turn with me to Leviticus 18 for just a moment. Leviticus 18. And see what we find there. Leviticus 18, we're looking at verse 22 in Leviticus 18. The entire chapter of Leviticus 18, by the way, has to do with sexual relationships. There are a number of passages in the Bible on sex, longer passages, and this is one of them. But in this passage, verse 22, Leviticus 18:22, you shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Abomination to the Lord, of course. And here's what you have. Now, let's take a look at this for a moment. Wars, culture wars, are first begun and won in semantics, the use of words. Virtually every state had a law against sodomy. The Supreme Court, was it in the 90s? I can't remember, not being an attorney, struck down the Texas sodomy law, and of course with it, all the other states as well. The sodomy laws really didn't touch what two people would do in privacy. They had to do with people who were apprehended in public places. And bottom line was basically public decency. That's why the laws existed. They never touched anybody who was in the privacy of their own home, their own room, their own hotel room. Of course not. Who would know? The authorities would not know. But it had to do with public acts. Where did the word sodomy come from? Sodom and Gomorrah, Genesis chapter 19. Sodom was the ancient to San Francisco or north side of Chicago. Take your pick. And it was a city given over, of course, to unnatural sexual relations. And you can read the details, which we'll not pause to do. And if you haven't read them, you ought to read them in that chapter. These guests come to visit Lot, and the men of the city are after these guests, fresh flesh, and he offers his daughters, which shows how low Lot had fallen, and they don't want the daughters. They want these men who'd come to visit Lot. And you know the result of it, that the city is destroyed Gomorrah with it, the twin cities, with fire and brimstone, these cities, actual cities existing down just southeast off the Dead Sea in Israel. So since God destroyed these people for these perverted sexual practices, there is some baggage with the word Sodom and sodomy, negative baggage. And that's where battle one was waged by these people in their effort to make themselves respectable, unashamed, non-guilty members of society. So we got the term homosexual. The word homosexual is a sterile, clinical term which sheds the baggage of immorality that goes along with the sodomy term. But notice something. Christian writings, I'm not talking about the left and the liberals now, I'm talking about evangelicals and fundamentalists included, use the term homosexual. It's the accepted term among people. So that crowd won that battle. Now, not only did they win that battle, but they moved on to adopt another term to describe themselves, which is gay. Well, they're hardly gay people. What should be your attitude toward these folk? I think one of compassion. That's my heart. Here, anybody who is struggling with an identity problem deserves our compassion. A lot of people struggle with identity problems. Kids growing up struggle with identity problems. Now, however, here are people who are struggling with their sexual identity. Am I a man? Am I a woman? Should I relate to other women or should I relate to men? It is a really a sad situation and not a gay situation. These are not happy people. And because of this burden of guilt, the plan is not to repent and seek help, but the plan is to get everybody to agree that they're okay. And that's what's going on in our culture at the present time. Now, in this passage before us tonight, there are a lot of sins mentioned, detailed, before we get to the end of this chapter. And the question is raised, why is there so much discussion about sodomites and lesbians? And you can hardly turn the television or pick up the newspaper, and a few days ago the Indiana governor signed a law, and he's being threatened with companies moving out of Indiana and boycotting. How do you boycott a whole state right in the center of the country? You're not supposed to do business with them. I guess you're not supposed to travel through and buy gas or go to McDonald's in Indiana. Boycott the state because they signed a law, by the way, which is just in substance the same that Congress passed in 1993 and Bill Clinton signed, a law that was designed to protect the religious freedom of people in this country, which has been threatened. So there's the Christian baker who sold to sodomites but would not produce a cake for a quote-unquote wedding. and now the business is destroyed. Or the florist, oh, why not buy your flowers at another place? Surely someone else will bake your cake, gladly make the profit on it. Chris?
Are they born that way?
No, it is not genetic. It is not genetic. In other words, let me continue with what you raised. We are all born sinners. Psalm 51. However, thanks be, we do not all sin in exactly the same way. I may have some sin that you don't have, and you may have one that I don't have. We all are sinners, and we all sin. And so the thief, was he born that way, you know? No. The murderer, was he born that way? The sodomite, was he born that way? The pedophile, was he born that? We're all born sinners, and it's going to express itself in some way. But we have strong clinical evidence that what you mentioned simply is not true. Yes?
What about when someone is born as a morphinite?
There are all kinds of people who are born with physical infirmities, and they pertain not only to limbs and organs, but to a person's sexuality is part, it's a result of the fall. That's all.
Do we say, don't blame the sinner, and don't condemn the sinner, condemn the sin.
Don't condemn the sinner, condemn the sin. No judge who sits on the bench would go with you. He sends the sinner to the penitentiary. You can't separate the two. Sin is not floating around loose in the air someplace. Somebody commits a sin. I think we say we love the sinner, but rebuke the sin. Yes, we have compassion for these persons. And this church, of course, has a long history of sodomites being in our classes, in our services. When in the hospital, we visit them. When they die of AIDS, we bury them. In other words, what is our attitude toward lesbians, toward sodomites? The same attitude we have toward all sinners. Is this sin worse than any other sin? Well, no. Perhaps the worst sin is somebody's sin that impacts your life. If the arsonist burns down your house, now that's a bad sin to you because you lost a house over it. And if the deranged person who is hell-bent on murder runs over your son on purpose, now then that's, of course, big to you. Yes?
Or that pilot that...
That's a sad situation, that pilot who took the plane into the Alps. Into the mountainside, yes. But now, why all the fuss about sodomites? There is because they are making the fuss. That's all. We've never fussed about it. Do adulterers get parade permits and hold parades down public streets? Do thieves ask for special rights? See? You say, what rights does a lesbian, a sodomite have? Same rights you have. Same rights I have. Why under our Constitution should there be special rights for certain people? No, we're all citizens. We're equal before the law, so on. So here is... a heading on an item, tolerant homosexual activist threatened state senator for bill. Senator Joseph Silk in Oklahoma. And so the published story says, hundreds He's putting through a bill. Hundreds and hundreds of vulgar, vile emails, just absolutely hate mail, death threats to him and his family, horrible backlash from the LGBT community, threats, so on. Oh, my, my. So it's at the place, see, where if some preacher preaches against that he's likely to be accused, it has taken place in Canada, of hate speech. Those involved in it and committing it have made a crusade to make their lifestyle legitimate. And they're out for anyone who differs with them. State senator, U.S. senator, congressman, business person, anybody. They're after them. And do I think that sodomites should have rights? Lesbians? Absolutely. All the rights that I have. No fewer rights. But no more. You don't need... And when granting, you see, when you grant special rights to anybody, you're taking away rights from someone else, is the way the law functions. And that's the problem. So as you follow this, and as a string of states have the same kind of legislation that was passed in Indiana, they just chose to pick on it there, that's all. But if sinners of different kinds choose to legitimize their sinfulness and parade and get the media on their side and ask for special legislation to exempt them and cover them, well, then the same for them. But it's an interesting question. Question.
Isn't it basically the job of the ministers, and they're considered to be Christian ministers, Christian pastors all over the country. Isn't it their job to speak about the word and to bring this out and say that this is wrong, rather than looking at the audience and wondering, well, maybe I should go with
Okay, now you're going to blame the preachers for this, huh?
I'm not blaming well, the preachers, but there's many of them who, you look at the Presbyterian Church, what they just passed.
Well, okay, well, let's go, since you raised it, you know, the churches, the preachers, let's go down the list. Back in the 1980s, the most liberal denomination, other than the Unitarian Universalists, which is just a handful of people. The most liberal denomination, not too big, is the United Church of Christ, which is Congregationalists and others merged. They went, quote, open back in the 1980s and accepted lesbians as ministers and sodomites as ministers and were gung-ho on the same-sex union thing. And while we're there, let me pause and say, there is no same-sex marriage. There are same-sex unions, but not same-sex marriages. You do not change something by changing the name on it. It does not work that way. This is, as you can plainly see, and anyone would acknowledge, a wristwatch. But I'm saying now, this is a cuckoo clock. Has it changed?
No.
Not at all. Changing the name on something does not change what it is. Now, you take marriage as a union, a lifelong union between a man and a woman. Now, you call it, so you have two men or two women. And so that's a marriage. No, It is not. It's a union, perhaps, but not. It is not a marriage. And you can change the name, but you haven't changed marriage. Marriage was instituted by God and still stands, that's all. And so there we are. Now, United Church of Christ. Then, I'm trying to think. Thank you. The Episcopalians went, lesbian bishops even, and so on. Then ELCA, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, went in their conference in Minneapolis, and just recently the Presbyterian Church USA. Now, there are Lutherans who didn't go, the Missouri Synod, the Wisconsin Synod. There are Presbyterians who didn't go. There are several other Presbyterian groups. The Pres USA is only one and the most liberal. The Methodists, they're working on that hard, but it did not go. And it's interesting. The Methodists have their big meeting quadrennially, every 4 years. And these other bodies, United Church of Christ, ELCA, the Lutherans, Pres USA, Episcopalians, are United States denominations. The Methodist Church is global, not just the United States. And when they met, I think it was this last year again, they're coming from Korea, from Africa, and so if it were just Methodist from U.S., but in Africa, conservative vote didn't pass. And that's the way it is. But these denominations have not only lost thousands of members, they have lost whole congregations also over this, people who say they've departed from the Bible. So here it is in Scripture. This is just one passage, that's all. And then it goes on with verse 29. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, and now comes to the end of the chapter like this. Well, it invites a lot of hard work and a lot of study. This is an example of where using multiple translations may be of value to you. Online, you may not get too much help. For instance, King James and New King James. Well, and then the ESV is pretty much a revision of those, so you don't get much there. But go to the 1984 New International, the New American Standard, and how many of you have an Amplified Bible or New Testament? Anybody in here? One, maybe two. It's in our library. That is helpful. It's not good for public reading because it piles up synonyms. But perhaps it's good for study. It opens up, and those who put it together have done their work in the Greek text. So on your study list, you should put the Amplified Bible, especially the New Testament. And comes the list. There are more sins, of course, than anybody has thought of, but here we come down the list. All manner of unrighteousness, evil, and covetousness, which is greed. I would dare say, there's not a person in this room who at some time or other has not been guilty of covetousness. Just plain old, ugly, green-eyed greed, that's all. When you feel it coming on, just give away some of what you have, that's all. That's a good cure for it, for the moment anyway. Malice. And they are full of envy. Don't say you've never envied anybody. This comes home. There are in here sins of the heart, notice. They are the most subtle and the most deceitful. Covetousness is a sin of the heart. Envy. Now murder, not so. That's open. And strife or wrangling. Do you ever get in a quarrel with anybody? Go back and forth. The opportunities are abundant. Thinking two days ago, I was with someone. Oh, it was interesting. The person was a wrangler, a strife. The individual knew I had a position which was not his and expressed his position. I didn't say anything. I knew it would not go anyplace. The individual had his head set in concrete, and it would have just been a messy situation, that's all. So I just said, okay, you know. There was not room for a civil discussion, let's put it that way. Just you let it. Surely you've been in a situation like that, more than one. And you just have to not get into strife, wrangling, deceit. Here we started out the class with this woman, Michelle Sopko, who went from 09 to 12 with a deceitful scheme. April is income tax month. Are you trimming a little here or there, you know, to lower your taxes? And then maliciousness, malice, maliciousness from the same. And gossips. I understand now that gossip is something that somebody else does, right? What is gossip?
People?
Well, I've talked about other people here tonight. Am I gossiping?
Untrue. Talking about other people, but it's untrue.
Saying something about another person that is untrue. And you have to be careful. You may believe it to be true. And you may be dead wrong. This is a good test to apply. The truth?
Under oath.
Under oath. What you have witnessed, heard with your own ears directly, not through a third party. What you've seen with your own eyes, that's a witness.
They don't want hearsay.
No hearsay. That's correct. And a lot of gossip is you picked up something and you can't wait to share it, you know, with somebody else. And so something that's untrue. But gossip can also be something that is
true,
but
hurtful.
Necessary. So I know that Bill's father is in prison. So I can't wait to tell all Bill's friends that his father is sitting in prison. And if they find out, they find out. But it's not my business to publish this. It's a matter of public record, you know, it's not a secret, but it's not my business to spread this around. If somebody needs to know it, they'll find out. So it may be truthful information that is unnecessary. In churches, it is well known that two places are prone to gossip. One is women tending nurseries who are not too well occupied, and they share a lot of stuff that they don't know about and half know and is unnecessary and so on. And church kitchens. We had one lady once, they're preparing a meal. And she said, "I'm leaving. I will not be part of this." And she walked out. How about that? Takes a little courage. A little courage. Those two places. And of course, with our heightened communications these days, you can't wait to send an email. Fallen onto some choice morsel someplace. Good journalists have a rule before they publish anything. Nobody's been to journalism school here. What? Bonafide sources. Not one. It's not always followed these days, but that's supposed to, the way it's supposed to work. Question? No.
No, I'm just saying a lot of the media, they just use nowadays they just say anonymous source.
Oh, yes. It used to be that there was a sharp division between the editorial pages and the news columns. That's sort of mushed together. Nothing against somebody. Maybe true, but it's not your business to peddle it. The word in the Greek is whisperers. Beware of anybody who lowers their voice to talk to you. You say, "Oh, what was that you were saying?" If it's not worth speaking out loudly, maybe it should not be said. Whisperers. This is anybody else around here? I got something to you. Beware of this kind of thing. And gossips and slanderers need something. What? A listening ear. The gossip would freeze, the slanderer would be ended if nobody would listen. And when somebody starts this with you, you will do the person a great help. Say, "Oh, listen, come with me and we'll go to him and talk to him about that." And many a times I've had people come to me with something that I'm supposed to do something about, you know, some deal that's gone awry. And I'm writing on a tablet as they talk what they're telling me about someone, and then I spin it around and say, "Read that, and will you sign that, please?" I've never had a person sign it yet. But they feel free talking. But they won't sign their name to it. But I'm supposed to go and straighten out some person or some situation on hearsay. No. And then the rope is around my neck. I have enough troubles without that. Haters of God. These people in our society, especially who've been very pushy since the 60s, and it's been creeping and escalating, and in this century really has taken off. These people hate God. Why do they hate God? Well, yeah, and God is in their way for living like they want. And since they hate God, they can't get a hold of him. So it's religion in general, churches, Bible teachers, anybody who holds to the scriptures, haters of God, and so on. So the word comes, see, that you hate us, Sodomites. Well, I've never met a Sodomite yet that I hated, or a lesbian. I treat them like anybody else. And like I say, I pour it out myself. I make long trips to visit people in the hospital and go out of my way to conduct funerals for them and not say that they died of AIDS in the obituary, you know, have a nice service. Like for any sinner, you know. We end up being the haters. But we are hated. And we are the tolerant ones. Our doors are open, and so on. But we're not bending the Bible. We can't forsake Scripture. We can't accommodate people who depart from the Word of God, pat them on the back and say, well, it's okay, don't worry about it, you know. God will overlook it somehow, I'm not sure but don't get upset about it. Down the list, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient, foolish, faithless, that's covenant breakers, people who, faithless, do not keep their word, heartless, ruthless. They know God's righteousness, 32, decree that those who practice some things deserve to die, not only do them, but give approval. Now, there's something keen. How do you give approval to someone who is definitely in sin? How do you give approval? Be silence. That's the first thing. Silence. How else?
You support them. You go with their hate. When they have a protest, you show up. When they write something, you write something.
Yeah.
They boycott a business, you boycott
them. Yeah, to go along with them. Your bodily presence is a strong signal of your approval of something. We had these folk live in California now, good people, a couple in our church. It was their only daughter who was marrying contrary to the Word of God. And their only daughter, and they did not go to that wedding. That takes guts. That takes courage. But they simply would not go. And you show approval of something by your presence there. You show disapproval by your absence. You do not celebrate something that is wrong. A baby shower for a baby that was conceived, or a baby that was conceived in fornication. Now, it's not the baby's fault, but this is not a conception to celebrate. If you want to help the people out privately, you do something, you give a gift, but you don't have a shower, which is a celebration. You do not celebrate sin, in other words. You do not give approval to sin. The list is here, and there are other lists in Scripture. Well, start in chapter 2 for next week, and any questions left over from this week, bring them in. Let's pray. Father, we ask that we may take your word seriously, which at times may put us on the spot, and we understand we may have to pay a price to do this. But help us to have the courage, help us to have the willingness, and help us to see our own lives in the light of your searching word. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.